السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
السلام عليكم. الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله لا إله إلا الله
اللهم صل على محمد إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ونبيه ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما All praise and glory belongs to Allah, we thank Him and we seek His help and His guidance and His pleasure and we turn to Him and Him alone seeking forgiveness for our sins And we ask Allah to protect us from the evil whispers within our souls and the consequences, the awful consequences of our misdeeds. For whomever Allah guides, no one can lead astray. And whomever Allah leaves without guidance, none can provide guidance to that person. And we testify that no one is worthy of our worship, our devotion, our love and obedience in their most absolute sense, but Allah, alone without any partners, the true Supreme King, and that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam was in truth his prophet and his servant and his messenger, whom Allah sent as a bearer of glad tidings and as a warner and as nothing but a mercy to all the worlds. O people of Iman, O you who have believed, have the taqwa of Allah, remain mindful of Allah, keep obedient to Allah in the manner that He deserves, to the extent that He is entitled to, meaning as best as you possibly can, and do not die except in a state of complete and total surrender to Allah, a state of Islam. To begin, after welcoming my brothers and sisters to the house of Allah Azza wa Jal, it is hard to imagine that there is a Muslim that does not know that Allah expects of them and demands of them for they to love their fellow Muslims. However, what does that mean exactly? What is the reality of loving someone, loving a Muslim for the sake of Allah? It means to intentionally, deliberately get yourself emotionally attached, that's certainly a part of it, to your fellow Muslims. Was that possible? Can I control the way I feel about people? Of course, because Allah would not expect of you to do something that's impossible. And His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us of things that if we do them, it would enhance the love between us. أَفَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ إِذَا فَعَلْتُمُوهُ تَحَابَبْتُمْ أَفْشُ السَّلَامَ بَيْنَكُمْ. Shall I not inform you of something, a practice, that if you do it, it will increase the love between you. You will love one another as a result of it. Increase the greetings. Give salam to those you know, those you don't know. And he said to us, alayhi salatu wasalam, give gifts to one another. It will generate love in each of you. Tahadu tahabbu. And so it is possible to do this. But what is this exactly? What is that state? We want to identify it so we can make sure we're en route to it. What does it mean to love someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It perhaps can be summarized in two things. It means you are loving someone out of your love for Allah. You're loving them for Allah because it's because of Allah that I love them. Because loving Allah is the innermost core of your faith, the innermost core of Islam. And then loving people for Allah, that's how you complete your faith now. It is the completeness of your iman. And so the more beloved a person is to Allah, the more the beloved they would be to me. And that's why he said, for example, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين. No one of you has full faith, complete faith, until I am more beloved to them than their parents, their children, all of people combined. Why? Because he's the most beloved to Allah. And so if your faith is complete, the most beloved to Allah would be the most beloved to you. And those 1 degree further from Allah would be 1 degree further from you. So loving for Allah is loving people out of your love for Allah, you would love them. So I love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam more than anyone. And then I love the Sahaba radwanullahi alayhim, and those that inherited their legacy and sacrificed to spread it, the scholars of Islam, and so on and so forth. The second meaning here, loving for Allah, is to love them for the closeness they grant you to Allah. Meaning you love them because they bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why when he was describing the 7 in Allah's shade, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَرَجُلَانِ تَحَابَّ فِي اللَّهِ اِجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِ عَلَى الْخَيْرِ الَّذِي يُحِبُّهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ اِجْتَمَعُوا عَلَيْهِ وَتَفَرَّقُوا عَلَيْهِ. Two men, and this could be women of course, the point is the quality, not the gender here. Two people that love one another for Allah, they get together upon Him, upon nearness to Him. And so they get together upon knowledge, upon remembrance, upon prayer, upon charity, upon da'wah, upon self-development, upon good causes. And so from there, now, how do our relationships measure up against this rule book? So those that I love because we share mutual advice, we cooperate on good causes, these are people that your love for them may be for Allah Azza wa Jal. Whereas the people that we get together for leisure only, the people we get together and stay up late at night with, people that we get together with and we backbite with, wal'iyadhu billah, then this cannot be for the sake of Allah. Even if we're both Muslim, even if it happens inside the masjid, this is just because we have similarities. We have common behavior, so we gravitate towards one another. And so a relationship for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal has to be something that is going to increase your iman in Allah, going to remind you about Allah, remind you about the home of the hereafter. It cannot be something, it can never be something that distracts you from Allah or detracts from your nearness to Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is important because many people, when they become religious, they become more religiously committed, they overlook that their relationships must also be for the one that they decided they're going to devote their life to. This is not just external practices. This is not just selective submission to Allah. I'm even submitting to the arrangement of personalities in my life according to His pleasure, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so, for example, if you are, and everyone does this, they tell themselves, many people do this, should I say, they tell themselves, I love so-and-so for the sake of Allah. Where in reality, this is a religious shell for you loving them for your own sake, because you like the person. So how do we convince ourselves it's for Allah? You'll find someone you like. And then you'll dig out good qualities that Allah loves in someone that you like. So you convince yourself the relationship is for Allah. And then you find someone you don't like. And you dig up qualities that Allah hates in that person to convince yourself I don't like them for the sake of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But who doesn't have this in them? Who doesn't have good and evil in them? Was that really your reason? It requires investigation. Likewise, when people get together, for example, to do Islamic work, but they're doing things that would distance them from Allah Azza wa Jal, like sabotage someone else's da'wah project, ruin someone else, collaborate to ruin someone else's da'wah or reputation or livelihood. Or when we're getting together, sometimes the youngsters in the college, they're doing things in an Islamic framework and religious shell, but they're mixing between the genders in a way that's inappropriate. That cannot be a relationship that's for the sake of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or if people come into the masjid and they gravitate towards groups based on classism or sectarianism or otherwise, can this possibly be for Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala? It requires reconsideration. What do I really love this person for? Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he used to say, most of the relationships in our time, in Ibn Abbas's time radiallahu anhuma, have become for worldly reasons, worldly interests. Like what? Like your coworker. This is a worldly relationship. You visit them and they visit you, and when you're sick you exchange kind words, and when someone dies you extend condolences, and that whole relationship, it is for work, it's not for Allah, obviously. When most people retire, those communications, those relationships vanish in thin air. Why? Because I don't get anything out of you anymore. I have no interest in upholding this relationship anymore. I get nothing out of it. So in reality, that relationship was self-serving. It was about you. It was for your sake, not for anyone else's sake. And by the way, when people do get neglected in retirement, they suffer a great deal emotionally. Likewise, Allah Azza wa Jal did not want anyone to suffer. Most importantly, religiously, and so He said the believers must always be one body. You know, just as the wise saying goes that it takes a whole village to raise a child, Allah knows that confronting all of the temptations and all of the confusions, confronting jahiliyyah, the anti-guidance in the world, this requires a solid body that has no inlets. people collaborating with one another, gravitating towards one another, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى, helping each other in goodness and in piety. If there are hard feelings that linger for long enough, you will give up on that mission. I can do it on my own. I don't need anyone. And you will move away from the people that your security and their security is dependent on each other. And that's why our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to us, مَا مِنْ ثَلَاثَةٍ فِي قَرْيَةٍ وَلَا بَدْوٍ لَا تُقَامُ فِيهِمُ الصَّلَاةِ إِلَّا اسْتَحْوَذَ عَلَيْهِمُ الشَّيْطَانِ فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِالْجَمَاعَةِ فَإِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُ الذِّئْبُ مِنَ الْغَنَمِ الْقَاصِيَةِ. He said, there are never three people in any town or even in the deserts that do not come together upon prayer. They don't hold jama'ah together. They don't congregate together upon the salah, except that shaitan will be able to entrap them. Divide and conquer. Will be able to entrap them. He says, so stick together, stick to the community, stick to the congregation, because the wolf only eats from the sheep the one that strays. He's trying to get us to understand, alayhi salatu wasalam, you may think you can do it on your own, but the shaitan is the wolf of humanity. If we stray, we will be devoured. And so our relationships for the sake of Allah need to be kept like this. But is this an easy task? Certainly not. Absolutely not. Putting up with each other is not easy. But who can do it? Someone that knows its value. Someone that knows the stakes. What is at stake? Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. And don't you dare dispute, or else you will fail. You think when you dispute with your brother or sister, over whatever, even if it's rightful causes, and you hurt each other, if one of the two wins the argument, you think you really won? When you dispute, you fail, he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. And your wind will be lost. Your wind will be lost, meaning your strength to move forward in your journey to Allah will be lost. Or rihukum could actually mean your wind as in your scent, meaning there will not be a trace left of you on the face of the earth or in that community, in that congregation. And so with this in mind, my brothers and sisters, that the deen will suffer with any semblance of disunity, to the degree of the disunity, the deen will suffer both physically, the ummah bleeds, and spiritually as well. You know, growing up, they used to say to me that right before shaitan comes, right before Ramadan comes, shaitan comes and tries to ruin relationships. There's always nasty fights every year before Ramadan, either inside the house with the families or inside the communities in the masajid. Because he knows that if you come together in this month, good things are going to happen. He understands the stakes. We need to understand them as well. And then I grew a bit older, and I began to read that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam even said, by the time Sha'ban is halfway over, you have Allah's forgiveness. He didn't teach us to do any particular act of worship in the middle of Sha'ban. But he said, by the midway point of Sha'ban, you can earn Allah's forgiveness for all that's been piled up throughout the year, except two types of people. Mushrikun aw mushahin. He said a polytheist, someone that associates, that's equals with Allah, or someone that holds grudges. Subhanallah, it seems to feed into the same theory. And then when communities develop and they begin to show signs of health, when masajid, when people come together upon good things and they're picking up steam and momentum is going, you begin to notice again, there, sometimes you see a little, and you say, subhanallah, shaitan knows the value of unity, knows the value of us putting up with each other, and he's going to do everything he can to make sure it doesn't happen. Because if it happens, this ummah is going places. If it happens, he may never have a chance again to come at these Muslims. But so it's hard, but you know the stakes, shaitan knows the stakes, you need to as well. But we do need to address one more thing. Why is it hard? Why is it so hard to tolerate each other? In the family, in the masjid, in the ummah, whatever. Why is it so hard? Because it demands of us to get over ourselves a little bit. It demands of you, and this is the reality of loving for Allah, to remove yourself from the middle of your life and to place Allah, meaning your love for Allah, in the middle of your life. Whatever is closer to Allah is closer to me. Whatever is farther from Allah is farther from me. It's not about me. Whoever is nicer to me comes closer, and whoever is nastier with me moves farther away. It's not about me. That's not an easy thing to do, because you can stop trying to impress people when you become quote-unquote religious, but there's still one more person you're trying to impress. Yourself. You know who I am? You speak to me like that? You think I'm gonna let that go? That's the last invisible idol that we worship that we need to break. The invisible one, the ego, the nafs, that needs to be broken so that we can streamline to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Yahya ibn Mu'adh al-Razi rahimahullah, he used to say, you know that your love is for Allah when it is not increased by kindness or decreased by harshness. Of course, you have a natural love for those that are kind to you, and naturally you're upset by those, but your love for Allah, it doesn't touch that category in your heart. That when someone is kind to you, I love this person more. And when someone is hurtful to you, because it's not about you. I remember one of the good authors I love reading for, he says, I'll never forget a time one man crossed me hard, insulted me, and the feelings of hate began to settle. And all of my rage began to consume me. And I felt like I will never be able to get past what this person did to me until I avenge myself. He says, and just when I thought that it was over, Allah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us and you this. He says, Allah saved me. And I was able to come to my senses a little bit. And I began to look for reasons to excuse them. Maybe they had a bad day. I've done things like this to people. And then I began to weigh his good against his evil. And then I began to think about the good times he's even been to me compared to this one time he snapped at me. Until finally I was able to get myself to be a bit fair with my brother. He says, and then I looked at the clock and I realized an entire hour had passed in this episode. In this conversation I was having with myself. He says, at that moment I realized the reality of brotherhood for the sake of Allah and its importance and its difficulty. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ونبيه ورسوله. Of the ways that we can invite this true love for Allah into our lives is to make dua for ourselves. As Allah taught us to say in the Quran, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Do not place in our hearts rancor, fury, malice, ill intent for anyone who believes, O Allah. Make that dua. The second one, the first dua, say it with earnest, with eagerness, knowing that you really can't do it on your own, because getting past yourself is the hardest obstacle that causes us to be so resentful of people sometimes. The second is to make dua for the person you have hard feelings against. Just hear me out. Because when you want to do it, shaitan is going to come and say, why are you making dua for this person? You hate them. Why would you do that? Are you out of your mind? Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he saw a man looking at another because of something he possessed, so he feared that he would envy. Envy is when you hate that someone has a certain position, a certain blessing, a certain favor. And the problem with envy is that your hate for that blessing transfers over very fast to the hate of the person that has it. Right? And so he feared this for the man. And so he said to him, Hala barakt? Did you ask Allah to bless him? So when you have this feeling, just try it. I've tried it. Try it. Say, oh Allah, use his name. Use her name. Oh Allah, bless so-and-so. Oh Allah, guide so-and-so. Oh Allah, make them happy. Oh Allah, accelerate their road to Jannah. Oh Allah, grant them what they want and bless them in it and bless their families. Make them better than me. If you keep doing this, you're going to find ease. You will find ease about this relative or this community member or this fellow Muslim. And the next time you look at that person, you're going to look with a completely different lens. You're going to look and say, you know what, subhanAllah, how many people come to the masjid anyway these days? He's one of the few and he brings his children. You know, how many people keep ties with their family and call every week? You'll begin to notice, because that's the key. If you want to excuse the person, if you want to love the person, you will be able to. And also cultivating this love is simply by expressing it. When our Prophet ﷺ said to the man, when he said, I love so-and-so, he said, أَلَا أَخْبَرْتَهُ? Did you inform him? Go inform him. There's even data nowadays to say that the longevity, the continuity of a marriage can be directly related, directly correlated, connected with the amount of times you tell your wife, I love you, each day. That if you say it at least 13 times a day, you have this higher chance of keeping the marriage going. And so express these things to your brothers. Express these things to your sisters. Express them to your family members. And then look, here's the fourth advice. You make dua for yourself, for them. Express the love. The fourth thing is, keep a healthy distance if you fear hard feelings. Don't go investigate, because we're weak. If you try to pry into people's lives, our Prophet ﷺ told you, don't pry. Don't spy. Don't even go asking. If you have a certain mental image of your brother, of your sheikh, of your relative, if that mental image gets ruined, gets blurred, it could be unreasonable, you're having high expectations, whatever, but if that image gets blurred, you may not be able to look at them the same way again. Right? So don't go looking for it. You know, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, just show you the understanding of the Sahaba and the purity of the Sahaba. They came to him and said, listen, this man, we see wine dripping from his beard. He said to them, Nuhina ani tajassus. We were forbidden by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from spying. You may be thinking right now, come on, this is just too much. Like, there's wine in his beard right in front of me. What more could there be to the story? But that's a problem with us. Isn't it possible he saw someone drinking wine and said, Ittaqillah, fear Allah, and the man spit in his face? Isn't it possible he woke up with a bad stomach this morning? And you know when you throw up, it has that same smell, the fermentation, right? The takhmir. Isn't it possible he threw up a few hours ago? And that's where the scent is. If you want to find an excuse, you'll find an excuse. But if you don't want to in the first place, the easiest thing to do is stick an allegation on somebody. You know, with this I close. I have 3 minutes left in the khutbah. And I'll be perfectly honest with you. The reason why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and this was very hard for me to understand for years, were still able to see value in each other despite any differences, even some differences that really went out of control at the end of the lives of some of the Sahaba, was that because they were able to see value in their brothers, in their sisters regardless. I need to love this person because Allah loves them, going back to the first definition. And I need to love this person so that I can come closer to Allah and Allah can love me. That's all that matters at the end of the day to the Sahaba radwanullahi alayhim. And so their behavior unfolded accordingly. I need to love this person for Allah to love me. Case closed. Because in Sahih Muslim, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَنَّ رَجُلًا زَارَ أَخًا لَهُ فِي قَرْيَةٍ أُخْرَى فَأَرْصَدَ اللَّهُ عَلَى مَدْرَجَتِهِ مَلَكًا فَلَمَّا أَتَى عَلَيْهِ قَالَ أَيْنَ تُرِيدُ. One brother went to visit another brother for the sake of Allah in another town. And so Allah sent on his trail, awaiting him, an angel in the form of a man. And he says to him, where are you going? When he finally reached him, the angel said, where are you going? قَالَ أَخًا لِي فِي هَذِهِ الْقَرْيَةِ. I'm visiting my brother, this sick brother of mine, or this brother I just seek to see in this town. قَالَ هَلْ لَكَ عَلَيْهِ مِن نِعْمَةٍ تَرُبُّهَا. Does he owe you any favor that you're going to accrue? Are you going to get anything out of this? Does he owe you something? Do you expect something? He's going to make you feel better, or he's going to give you some money, or you're going to get your money back that you lent, anything? قَالَ لَا غَيْرَ أَنِّي أُحِبُّهُ فِي اللَّهِ. He said, no, except nothing but the fact that I love him for Allah. قال فإني رسول الله إليك أن الله قد أحبك كما أحببته. Then know that I am the messenger of Allah carrying a message to you, that Allah has loved you just as you've loved him. You need to love your brothers to be loved by Allah. And when the man came to see Mu'adh ibn Jabal in Damascus, Abu Idris al-Khawlani, he said to him, I love you for Allah. He said, are you sure it's for Allah? He said, yes. He said, are you sure it's for Allah? He said, yes. He said, are you sure it's for Allah? He said, yes. He said, then hear this. I heard the Messenger of Allah tell us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that Allah has said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَجَبَتْ مَحَبَّتِي لِلْمُتَحَابِّينَ فِيَّ الْمُتَجَالِسِينَ فِيَّ الْمُتَزَاوِرِينَ فِيَّ الْمُتَبَاذِلِينَ فِيَّ My love has been guaranteed for those who love each other for my sake, and visit one another for my sake, and sit together for my sake, and sacrifice for each other for my sake. May Allah make us of those whose love for the Muslims is true, the Muslims near and the Muslims far, the Muslims present and the Muslims past. May Allah fill our hearts with love for Him, and love of those who love Him, and love of those whom He subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. Allahumma ameen. May Allah forgive us our wronging of our brothers, and may Allah forgive our brothers for their wronging of us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for what only He knows about us. Allahumma aghfir lana warhamna. Allahumma aghfir lana warhamna. Wa ila ghayrika la takilna. Allahumma aghfir lana ma qaddamna wa ma akharna wa ma asrarna wa ma a'lanna wa ma anta a'lamu bihi minna. أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر وأنت على كل شيء قدير اللهم اغفر لنا هزلنا وجدنا وخطأنا وعمدنا وكل ذلك عندنا اللهم اجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر وقنا الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم وارحم الأموات وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين Are you waiting for that? Tfadl.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
استقيم وتراصوا straighten your ranks as best you can تراصوا اعتدلوا are the lines complete in the back? جزاك الله خيرا الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنفد البحر قبل أن تنفد كلمات ربي ولو جئنا بمثله مددا قل إنما أنا بشر مثلكم يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. بسم الله الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين والتين والزيتون وطور سينين وهذا البلد الأمين لقد خلقنا الإنسان في أحسن تقويم ثم رددناه أسفل سافلين إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات فلهم أجر غير ممنون فما يكذبك بعد بالدين أليس الله بأحكم الحاكمين. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الله أكبر. استغفر الله. استغفر الله. استغفر الله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. First of all, JazakAllah khairan, Sheikh Muhammad, for the khutbah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite our community and allow us to love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, Sheikh Muhammad will be here tonight for us, inshallah. For the youth between Maghrib and Isha, inshallah, he will be giving a program for the brothers and the sisters, inshallah, upstairs. So please, all youth 12 and over, please attend, and also you parents, encourage your children to attend, inshallah. After Isha, inshallah, Sheikh Muhammad will address everybody, inshallah, on issues of ikhtilaf and how to deal with difference of opinion, inshallah, amongst us. Inshallah, that will be between after Isha, inshallah. All are encouraged to attend, inshallah. Also, today is the first Friday of the month. As we know this, we collect food for the local refugees. So please, inshallah, drop that off while you come and attend the lecture, inshallah. As you walk out, you will see there's some food for sale. Alhamdulillah, there's a youth program called Rise that they're raising money for, inshallah. So please do support them, inshallah. Tomorrow, inshallah, at 8 a.m., the sisters are having a program. The sisters are having a community breakfast, inshallah, for the sisters only. 8 a.m., inshallah, it is a gathering for all the sisters. They're all encouraged to come, inshallah. Tomorrow, also at 8 a.m., the Social Services Committee will be meeting to go to Mini Foods Pantry. So all are encouraged to attend, inshallah, as well. On Sunday, after Dhuhr, EPIC has adopted a street called on Betsy and Murphy, inshallah. After Dhuhr, everyone's encouraged to come, inshallah, and we'll all go together as a community and clean the street, inshallah. Next Friday, May 12th, inshallah, Sheikh Umar Sulaiman will be having a program on Salman al-Farsi. I was able to attend that program in UK. Alhamdulillah, it's a great program, inshallah. We encourage everybody to come. It's sponsored by Al-Maghrib, inshallah. The details will be emailed out to the community, inshallah. Next Saturday, inshallah, the Outreach Committee is having an interfaith dialogue program entitled Knowing Your God after Dhuhr, inshallah, on Saturday. Everybody is encouraged to attend. Next Sunday, on May 14th, EPIC is having a conference on welcoming Ramadan. Sheikh Omar will be here, Sheikh Abdel Nasser will be here, Brother Muhammad Faris will be here, Sheikh Arsalan will be here, Sheikh Abdurrahman Bashir will be here. Inshallah, it's a program, it's a great program, inshallah, all day, inshallah. I believe starting at 4 o'clock, but the flyer is there, inshallah. You can get all the details from you, inshallah. Also, next Saturday, there is a nature walk that for the community, inshallah. There will be at 10, that will be at Oak Point Reserve, inshallah. I think that's enough for today, inshallah. Please keep all the people, inshallah, in your dua, inshallah. Okay, assalamu alaikum wa barakatuh. Don't forget to donate, please. JazakAllah khair.